task today was to basically talk about when to send a patient to a really world-class EP lab like Dr. Pandurangi has today or anywhere else in India, and when to think about sending a patient to an EP study or an ablation. And you're going to find that the ECGs in this talk are kind of a mishmash of the different conditions that you've already come across today, because you've really had a very comprehensive course on ECGs today. So it's going to involve some of the ECGs that you already saw with Dr. Badwar, and also some of the wide complex rhythms that you saw before, some of the AV node block ECGs that you saw with Dr. Theodore. But essentially, the goal here is to start thinking about when should I really do a more comprehensive EP study? When should I really put catheters into these patients or refer a patient to know what is going on for diagnosis or for therapeutic purposes? So there's usually two different indications, broadly speaking, for when you want to do an EP study or a catheter study. One is if there's diagnostic uncertainty. So you have a patient, for example, with syncope, and you think it's probably cardiogenic in origin based on the history, but you're not sure what is causing it or how to manage the patient. Is it because of AV nodal block and pauses? Is it because of sinus pauses? Or is there syncope because of some white complex arrhythmia? That's one situation where you want to start thinking about doing an EP study, because the EP study can often provide you a lot of information about syncope of undetermined etiology. Another place where you start thinking about EP study is if there is a wide complex tachycardia and you're not quite sure about the differential diagnosis in that situation based on the ECG alone. Or if you want to go further and you have a patient with clearly, say, a pathway and you're unsure if it's a high-risk pathway or not, is there risk for sudden death in a patient with pre-excitation on an ECG? That's another time to start thinking about EP studies. And finally, the second reason why you would want to send a patient to an EP lab is if you feel there is going to be some therapeutic benefit. So what are the indications for ablation in patients with arrhythmias would be the second part that we'll be talking about. So we'll start with one ECG, and I actually initially prepared this presentation thinking it's going to be an interactive audience, so pardon me if there are some questions in between, but essentially I'll just go over these ECGs so we start recognizing patterns in your practice that would lead to an EP study. So this is a narrow complex tachycardia, very regular. And so you start thinking about all the supraventricular tachycardias for differential diagnosis. And this is one of the classic ECGs that we should all be able to recognize in practice, where there is narrow complex tachycardia, there is regularity to it, and then you see a small R prime wave in lead V1, and what we call a pseudo S in lead 2 and lead 3. So what that pseudo S wave is at the end of 2, 3, and what this R prime is at the end of V1 is actually the P wave. So the retrograde P wave causing that appearance on 12 lead ECG is a classic sign of AV NRT or AV nodal reentrant tachycardia. The reason I mention this is because this is the most common form of SVT in adults, and you can actually have about 95% success rate in ablating these arrhythmias with relatively low chance for complications. And patients typically do not come back a second time to see you once you ablate them. So this is a very satisfying type of arrhythmia to ablate. So if you find something like this, you want to start thinking about an EP study and ablation, provided you've already tried some of the drugs that we often try, like the beta blockers and the calcium channel blockers, and if patients still have recurrences, then you want to start thinking about an EP study and ablation. So again, a blown up view of that. Remember the RS pseudo R prime pattern in V1 and the pseudo S wave in 2 and 3. And this is the same patient when the patient is in sinus rhythm, you don't see that R prime in V1, and you don't see the pseudo S wave in 2 and lead 3. So just to go over some of the other SVTs that can cause a similar pattern and why that particular pattern was characteristic of AV NRT. As I mentioned, AV NRT is the most common SVT that you would encounter in adults. The second most common is pathway-related orthodromic reentrant tachycardias, and then you can have atrial tachycardias. So in this AV NRT rhythm, what you have is a small reentrant circuit that involves the AV node and part of the atrium, and there is simultaneous activation of the atrium retrograde and simultaneous activation of the ventricle antegrade. So you can basically have the QRS complex and the P wave getting activated at the same time. So if you have a SVT where either you cannot see the P wave because it's sitting right in the QRS complex, or if you see a P wave right at the end of the QRS complex, like I just showed you with the R prime and lead B1, that's pretty much diagnostic of AV and RT with a few exceptions. An accessory pathway-related tachycardia will also produce a P wave right at the end of the QRS or just after the QRS has ended, but the QRS to P wave interval typically is at least 70 milliseconds, because if you can think about it, this ORT rhythm is also a reentrant rhythm, but it takes a finite amount of time for the electrical impulse to go down the conduction system, back up an accessory pathway, and then produce a P wave. So there is a finite interval between the QRS and the P wave, and it's usually more than 70 milliseconds at least. So if you actually see a P wave within the QRS, start thinking about AV and RT in those situations. And atrial tachycardia is usually just a spot in the atrium that's firing spontaneously. The P wave is going to be closer to the next QRS interval, just like sinus tachycardia would look like. This is another example of an SVT with a narrow complex, regular tachycardia, and here the P wave is after the QRS complex, so you can clearly see it in the inferior leads here, if I can make this work, right there. So you can see it's not on top of the QRS, it's not at the end of the QRS, but it's a little distinct from the QRS, and this patient ended up having a pathway-related tachycardia that was ablated. So all of these tachycardias that are SVTs, narrow complex and regular, you want to start thinking about what the differential diagnosis would be, but the management often initially is a beta blocker or a calcium channel blocker, as long as there isn't pre-excitation on the baseline ECG. And if those things don't work, and they often do not work, historically, if we look at data, only 20 to 30% of patients would be arrhythmia-free if you try a beta blocker or a calcium channel blocker. So if those things don't work, you start thinking about membrane-active antiarrhythmic drugs and an ablation procedure. And I would say that an ablation does much better than a membrane-active antiarrhythmic drug, like, say, flecainide or amiodarone, compared to doing an ablation. So the ablation typically has a 90-95% success rate in these types of SVTs, and patients can avoid many of the side effects that can come out of membrane-active antiarrhythmics. So according to the American Heart Association guidelines, it kind of reiterates what I just said. If the AV nodal blockers don't work, they say class one indication, which is the highest level of indication, is ablation. And class two is some of the membrane-active antiarrhythmics that we can give. So another ECG, a slight change in focus. Here it's not a regular tachycardia, nor is it a narrow complex tachycardia. This is one of the things that we should all learn to recognize and practice, because what we do after this really determines life or death for the patient, right? So this is a irregular tachycardia, broad complex. And if you look closely, there's a lot of variability in the actual QRS morphology from beat to beat, depending on how the RR interval is. So the top differential diagnosis for this is pre-excited atrial fibrillation. So a patient with an accessory pathway that conducts in the antegrade direction, causing pre-excitation of the ventricle, is an atrial fibrillation and is going really fast. So the one thing that we do not want to do when we see this type of ECG is to give an AV nodal blocker. So we do not want to give things like adenosine, we do not want to give beta blockers or calcium channel blockers, or amiodarone for that matter, which has a pretty significant beta blocking activity, particularly when given IV. So what do we want to do in these situations? Oh, before we go to that, so this is what happens if we do end up giving a beta blocker to these patients by mistake. So we start out with pre-excited atrial fibrillation. We give a little bit of adenosine, block the AV node, and now there's going to be more conduction across the accessory pathway, so the rate increases further. And a little more adenosine, the rate goes to such a fast rate that you risk the chance of having ventricular fibrillation and death of the patient. So that's really why you don't want to give AV nodal blocking agents. So what do you want to do in these situations? To some extent, it depends on the clinical stability of the patient. If the patient is hemodynamically stable, there's a case to be made. Maybe we can give IV procainamide. But in most of these situations, you want to sedate the patient and cardiovert them. So acutely, cardioversion is typically what is used if you see a pre-excited atrial fibrillation. But once you're done with that in the emergency room setting, that's when you want to start thinking about further risk stratification and treatment of these patients, and that's where the EP study and ablation comes in. So again, in these situations, a pathway can be mapped and ablated with at least 90-95% success rate in the long term, and this is actually a very good indication for an EP study. So another ECG going along the same theme of accessory pathways. Here you can see the patient is actually in sinus rhythm, nice normal sinus rhythm, P waves. But there is a beat-to-beat change in what the QRS looks like. So this QRS is showing us a delta wave. So there is some pre-excitation going on. But these two QRSs do not. And then the next three do show delta wave, but this one does not. So what is happening here is there really isn't a whole lot of change in the sinus rate, but there is still this intermittent pre-excitation on the ECG. So if you see this type of pattern, the first question you're going to ask is this a high-risk pathway, right? So is this a pathway that I need to worry about that the patient may come back later with atrial fibrillation that's pre-excited to the point of risking ventricular fibrillation? So if you see this pattern, the answer is no. So if you're at a normal rate, you see sudden loss of pre-excitation on the ECG, this pathway is a low-risk pathway as far as sudden cardiac death is concerned. Now, this pathway may still cause some of the ORT type of rhythms we talked about. This may still cause SVT and palpitations, but this is not going to be high-risk for sudden death. So this is the kind of patient where you can reassure with regards to sudden death risk without actually putting them through a EP study. So what are the high-risk features of an accessory pathway? And when I say high-risk, I'm referring to the risk of sudden death, which is kind of the top question in these patients. So if you see a shortest pre-excited interval of less than 250 milliseconds, particularly during atrial fibrillation, you need to be thinking about a high-risk pathway, potentially high-risk pathway. If there is evidence for multiple accessory pathways, which is not very common unless you deal with congenital heart disease and Epstein's patients, but if there is multiple accessory pathways in the same patient, there is historically data that they are at higher risk for sudden death. Again, Epstein's anomaly, and if there is intermittent pre-excitation and abrupt loss of pre-excitation like I showed you on the previous ECG, that's a nice sign that tells you that the risk for sudden death is not high. We'll skip this one in the interest of time. But before we go to the next topic here as to when an EP study is useful, one more thing that I would emphasize is another reason why a patient with pre-excitation would benefit from an EP study and ablation is if they are having recurrent SVTs and palpitations. So sudden death risk is not the only concern in these patients. So if you treat a patient with orthodromic reciprocating tachycardia or ORT with some drugs, give them beta blockers or calcium channel blockers, particularly if there is no pre-excitation on the surface ECG, but they still come back to you with the same symptoms, that's a good reason to go ahead and ablate them. So switching gears a little bit, so this is a patient with syncope. And this is very similar to the concepts that Dr. Theodore just emphasized, and I think this is really important to take home. And he did a really nice job talking about nodal versus infranodal AV nodal disease. So this is a patient who came in with syncope, relatively old, 67-year-old, and you can see there is sinus rhythm marching through, and then there is a sinus beat without a QRS, and then again two more sinus beats, and then another dropped QRS. So this is a type 2 AV block. And what is more important to notice in this situation is the infrahessian disease that you see. So there is bifascicular block on the ECG. So whenever you see AV conduction abnormalities, whether it's 2-to-1 block or type 2 higher grades of AV block, if it's combined with infrahessian disease, And what is infrahessian disease? In infrahessian disease, you're going to find that there is delay in one of the bundle branches or in one of the fascicles. So there's a classic right bundle or a left bundle pattern, but or if there is a right bundle pattern with bifascicular block, those are all patterns for infrahessian disease. Those are high-risk situations for causing for patients to have higher grades of AV block for, and also for sudden death. So you should be jumping on these patients sooner and putting pacemakers in these patients. This would be an indication for a pacemaker. But there are certainly some situations where you don't always document what's happening during syncope. So that's one of the challenges in practice. Patients may have syncope once a month or once in 2 or 3 months, and you're unable to document what is happening during the syncopal spell. So in those situations, an EP study is often very helpful. So this patient was taken to the EP lab, and here we are measuring intracardiac electrograms. You have the surface ECG here, and what is marked in yellow here is the His catheter. So this is a catheter that's positioned at the His location. And just to kind of orient everyone, these small signals here are atrial signals. The Sharpie here is the His signal. And this is the ventricular signal on the His electrogram. So to determine how long it takes for the electrical impulse to go down the His bundle and then down the bundle branches, you basically look at the interval between the His electrogram and the QRS. And if that is prolonged, you know that there is a lot of infrahessian disease or infranodal disease going on, and that really is a good indication for a pacemaker. So in patients with undetermined etiology syncope, doing an EP study, looking at what the His to V interval and the A to V interval and the A to H interval are, can help you determine if a patient needs a pacemaker or not. But if you clearly can document what's happening during a syncopal episode, this may not be necessary. Another thing we can do during an EP study is to give drugs to see if drugs would precipitate or unmask infranodal disease. So here we start out, this is a different patient from what I just showed you. We are starting out with the baseline intervals here. So again, this Sharpie here is the His electrogram. And then the ventricular electrogram. Here, the His to ventricular electrogram actually looks quite normal, but the patient came in with syncope and there is some concern that there is probably infranodal disease. So here we have given procainamide to challenge the infrahessian conduction system, and you can see that suddenly the H to V interval prolongs and there is actually a split in the His signal, which means that there is intrahessian conduction delay. So again, emphasizing the importance of infranodal disease that can be discovered during an EP study. And this would basically push us more towards a pacemaker in this patient, whereas before the study, we weren't quite sure why the patient was having syncope. So moving on to another indication for EP study, this is a patient with white complex tachycardia. This is just organized a little bit differently, but still this is lead one. We have all the limb leads here, and then the precordial leads down here. This is white complex tachycardia with a left bundle branch type of morphology. And there is one-to-one VA association. So this is a QRS complex, and then the P waves are here. So the differential diagnosis for this type of arrhythmia would include ventricular tachycardia, but it doesn't prove that this is ventricular tachycardia. You still have to think about supraventricular arrhythmias with aberrancy, or in other words, supraventricular arrhythmias with left bundle branch block. Another potential differential diagnosis for this would be something like an atriofascicular pathway or a Maheim pathway. So all those things would be treated differently. All those conditions would have different prognostic implications. So this is another important indication for an EP study. So if you have a white complex tachycardia, where you're unsure what the diagnosis is. Is this SVT with aberrancy? Is this ventricular tachycardia? Should I be aggressively working this patient up or treating with amiodarone? So those are questions that an EP study can answer for you. So in this situation, this particular patient I'm showing you ended up having an atriofascicular pathway, which was ablated during the procedure. So we didn't have to go and treat this patient with amiodarone thinking this was ventricular tachycardia. So a similar kind of tachycardia, another situation of relatively wider complex tachycardia. It actually looks quite similar to what you just saw, right? And I'll show you another ECG of the same tachycardia, same patient, where it becomes much more clear as to what this is. So this is a situation where there are wide complex beats, but you have narrow complex beats coming in between, called capture beats. So the sinus rhythm is intermittently conducting down to the ventricle. So if you have this type of capture beats, you know that you're dealing with ventricular tachycardia as the etiology for this broad complex rhythm. So similar type of ECG, if you just looked at the first one, you would think that it looks very similar to the previous example that I showed you, but sometimes additional information from just ECG can confirm what it is. So this is not a situation where you have diagnostic equipoise, so you don't have to go to the EP lab just to know what the diagnosis is, but this is a situation where going to the EP lab for ablation would be helpful, particularly if patients don't respond to the antiarrhythmic drugs you give them. And then another situation that I think we are going to see more and more commonly in India as patients are having more coronary artery disease and are more frequently surviving their coronary artery disease. So as our care of coronary disease and angiography and PCI is improving, I think we are going to see more and more of this in India. I wouldn't be surprised if in 10 years our demographics and our patient population would look more like the Western population, where the majority of patients that we see are actually post-MI patients or post-non-ischemic cardiomyopathy diagnosis patients, dealing with patients with low ejection fraction and ventricular tachycardia diagnosis. So as an example, I'll give you a clinical scenario and show you a short ECG. So 65-year-old man has history of coronary artery disease, MI, ejection fraction is 40%, and presents with presyncopal symptoms. And it's sudden presyncope. He doesn't really completely lose consciousness, but it's very concerning. So he's given a Holter monitor, and this is what we see on the Holter monitor. There is non-sustained ventricular tachycardia. But we are really never able to capture what happened during the presyncopal spell because it's very rare. It's only rarely that he has it. So what do we do with this patient? Can we send him home with amiodarone? Can we just reassure him? Should something more be done? Should we just put an ICD in this patient? Are all questions that are going to come up more and more. And the ejection fraction is about 40%. So it's not a situation where you could make a case for primary prevention ICD or primary prevention defibrillators, which are usually devices that are given for patients with ejection fraction less than 35%. So what do you do in these situations? An EP study would be of immense help. So we would put a catheter into the ventricle and stimulate the ventricle at different rates to see if we can reproduce a ventricular arrhythmia. And if you can, and if it's sustained and it's hemodynamically unstable, that's a good indication to put an ICD in. You can convince yourself and your patient that an ICD is needed in that situation. So another indication for an EP study is patients with ischemic cardiomyopathy who have ejection fractions that don't quite meet criteria for primary prevention ICDs, or ischemic cardiomyopathy patients who present with non-sustained ventricular tachycardia would all benefit from an EP study to further risk stratify what their risk for sudden death really is. And some of this data comes from the MUST trial, which is now relatively old, one of the earlier ICD trials where patients with ischemic cardiomyopathy, ejection fraction less than 40%, and non-sustained VT were tested. They all underwent, they basically were randomized to EP study guided defibrillator versus not, and patients who had EP study guided defibrillators had better survival compared to those who did not have the defibrillator in the EP study. And then finally, this is, again, as I said, this is going to, you're going to start seeing this more and more as we put ICDs in these patients. They're going to survive not only their initial myocardial infarction, they're also going to survive the subsequent ventricular tachycardia and sudden death risks. So these patients with ICDs often come back with ICD shocks because they're having monomorphic VT. And ICD shocks have two issues. One, they've been shown to reduce the survival of these patients. So the more the ICD shocks you get, there is some mortality associated with it. And two, patients are psychologically devastated with ICD shocks. It's really not fun to have one of those. So as we put in more and more of these CRTD devices and ICD devices, we see more of our patients come back with ICD shocks for ventricular tachycardia. And then the question comes up as to when to do a VT ablation in patients with structural heart disease. And the answer is very simple, I think, particularly in a situation like our country. The answer is fairly straightforward. You put them on a drug, and if the drug doesn't work and they still have ICD shocks, you have to start thinking about VT ablation. There is some case to be made that maybe you could ablate them even before putting them on a drug. I think the data behind that is kind of slim, and I don't think that has to be necessarily a primary approach. So VT ablation in structural heart disease with low ejection fractions, consider that if your antiarrhythmic drug is not working for you. So a slight change in the focus. So the EP study doesn't always mean that we are going to put catheters. Another form of studying these patients in the lab is to give drugs. So there are certain situations where giving a drug would help you diagnostically. So this is a patient who comes in with 22-year-old, so very young, comes in with sudden syncope, and I wouldn't call it a normal ECG. If you look at it carefully, you see some of that Brugada type pattern that was talked about earlier today. But it's not diagnostic, right? It's not meeting that 2-millimeter criteria. It doesn't have the type 1 or the type 2 pattern that you could put a label of Brugada syndrome on the patient for. So you could bring this patient to the EP lab and give either procainamide, or if agmaline is available in India, you could give agmaline. I would say agmaline is better than procainamide. So this is the top ECG that we already looked at, and this is with increasing doses of procainamide in our lab. And you can see with higher doses of procainamide, you can see the classic type 1 Brugada pattern. Now you have a diagnosis, you can tell your patient this is probably why you fainted, and an ICD is probably indicated in these situations. And then the last concept that I want to cover is one of VT in the structurally normal heart. So what to do with those patients. So we talked about ischemic and non-ischemics and ventricular tachycardia, but what if a patient comes in with VT and has presyncope or syncope, but the heart is structurally normal? So this is another ECG pattern that you should really imprint in your mind, because this is very classic. So broad complex tachycardia, really rapid, and this actually happened during an exercise stress test. You can see it terminates towards the end of the tracing here. But the classic signs here are there is a left bundle branch block pattern in lead V1, so it's completely negative in lead V1, and it's completely positive with a large R wave in lead 2, 3, and AVF, and negative in AVR and AVL. So this is a classic pattern of outflow tract ventricular tachycardia. So tall positive R waves in 2, 3 AVF, and negative complexes in AVR and AVL. And why is that so? Because the outflow tract is the highest portion of the ventricle. So anything that comes out of the outflow tract is going to go towards your inferior leads and is going to be going away from AVR and AVL. If you think back to what Dr. Ullah's thought is about vectors this morning, AVR and AVL are kind of looking this way. So anything going away from the top of the heart is going to be negative in AVR and AVL. So if you see this pattern, you have to recognize it's outflow tract VT, and in a structurally normal heart, it's typically not associated with sudden cardiac death. So this is not an indication for an ICD. You want to treat this typically starting out with medications such as calcium channel blockers, beta blockers, and if those don't work, ablation actually works beautifully for this condition, usually about 80% chance that, you know, patients would get cured with an ablation. So again, another example of the same, just a little slower, so it's easier to see the QRS. V1 is left bundle branch type morphology, 2-3 AVF is tall positive R waves, AVR, AVL is negative. Think about outflow tract VTs in structurally normal heart. I'm going to skip some of these in the interest of time and just highlight one more ventricular tachycardia, which is rather uncommon but can happen in structurally normal hearts. And again, this is not typically an indication to put an ICD in. You should be treating these patients with medications. This is the classic verapamil sensitive ventricular tachycardia or fascicular VT, which has a right bundle branch block pattern, relatively narrower QRS complex with a sharp upstroke telling you that the activation is coming from the fascicular system, and this one is coming from the left posterior fascicular region. So again, another tachycardia that you could treat with medications, and if that doesn't work, you could send them for an ablation with a pretty high success rate. I think Dr. Ullas and his colleagues did one procedure in a fascicular VT yesterday and had really good success. So another example that you should be able to recognize. And then finally, I think this is coming up more and more in India. I'm sure you see thousands of atrial fibrillation patients every week, but there is really a subset of, and I'm sure you've heard about ablation for atrial fibrillation as well. It doesn't always work the same or great for every patient, but one subset that I want you to keep in mind where it actually does work quite well for atrial fibrillation ablation is the paroxysmal atrial fibrillation patients who clearly have a trigger event. So here it's a patient with paroxysmal AF, and this is how the patient's episodes always start on an ECG or a Holter monitor. You can see there is atrial tachycardia, there's rapid firing and little sinus, and then again rapid firing, and if you follow this tracing towards the right a little more, later on the patient would be in atrial fibrillation. This tells you that there is a trigger somewhere, typically it's in one of the large veins in the thorax, like the pulmonary veins and rarely the SVC. And if we go and ablate and isolate those pulmonary veins, you can really have good success in these patients. So this is one situation where it really does work well. So keep that in mind, paroxysmal AF patients, where you do see a trigger on the ECG, you want to think about atrial fibrillation ablation, particularly if one of your drugs don't work. So to conclude, think about EP study if you have a patient with syncope and you're unsure of the diagnosis. Think about it if you have a patient with wide complex tachycardia and the diagnosis is uncertain. So those are situations that are fairly frequent and the EP study would really help you determine whether you want to treat with an ablation or not, what kind of drug you want to give, and whether a device such as pacemaker or defibrillator would be indicated. And thank you for that.